Okay, it's the next day. I've been thinking about stuff, and here's what I come up with. I improved some of the connections. Not, I wouldn't really have any trouble with them, but I found some better ways to do it, so I did. I looked up the specs for this controller, and it is indeed 60 amps. The voltage range is 10 to 50 amps, and I think the problem I was having yesterday was that this little motorcycle battery was dropping below 10 volts, which was causing this guy to shut off. So I've come up, well, I charged it up overnight on the trickle charger, and I came up with this battery boost to give it a little bit of help. So that it doesn't immediately drop down, and hopefully we can get some more amps out of it before it drops too low. Still haven't found a great way to get this amp meter to hold still. But another thing I did is I dug around and I found a 12-volt fan, and I came up with a rather ingenious way to connect it to these heat sinks, because they got hot yesterday, so I wanted to come up with a way to cool these down. And so 12-volt fan, 12-volt display are connected to a little 12-volt battery. So we'll get that started up. And then I've got my multimeter reading 12.4 volts. Got everything hooked up. Let's turn on our little jumper pack. There we go. It's detecting there's a battery, so it's happy to get started. And so let's give it a try here. Got power. Well, we got 10 amps. Fifteen amps, 20 amps ish. So that's already got quite a bit of torque. We're holding at about 11 volts there. 20 amps. Nothing's getting hot. That's actually really good. So, okay. Things seem all right. Let's keep going here. 25 amps, 30 amps. We're still at about 10.6 volts. Okay. Let's max it out at 38.8 amps. It's still at 10.3 volts. This is still nice and cool. That is a little warm. The aluminum's not, but the housing here is. We're still at 10.2, 10.1 volts, 38 amps. So, and I'm not going to try that. I'm sure it has plenty of torque. So let's go ahead and back it down. That's still not hot. That's very nice. So Gotta have at least, yeah, so. Yeah, hopefully that's in frame. You can see it's spinning in the direction I want it to. So that is great. Had a 50-50 chance of that. So one thing is this is definitely getting warm at 12 volts. And that's no surprise. This is cool to the touch here. Well, there's a little bit of, there's one little hot spot right over here. That's fine. Wires are a little warm, but not too bad. Okay, well, I'm going to go ahead and turn off the jumper pack here. Okay, let's see where we are. So we're still at 12 volts after all that. I still don't know how I'm going to get 30 volts into this to test it out without building the battery. But I really don't want to build the battery until I've tested this out and I can confirm it's going to work. But, yeah, I do think we're going to need some kind of way to cool this. Because we peaked out at about 38 amps, and I was hoping to put 60 into it. So that is a legitimate concern. So we'll have to figure that out. I can turn the fan off and the display. And the voltmeter, which, yeah, the battery's recovered to 12.1 volts already, so a little less stressful on the battery today with the little jumper pack. Yeah, so I still need to come up with a sprocket, a way to cool this. I don't know if... Well, hang on. Let me see. I bought this fellow ages ago for to cool a something. Anyway, it didn't fit. It's, I don't know. I'll have to try it out here. It's a little bit large, but perhaps I can modify this. I'm not using it for anything else. I can't use it for my original project, so if I could get this guy to wrap around here, without interfering with... Boy, that is just about the perfect width. Did you see that? Can you see that on the camera? That is almost the perfect width right there. And this is the part that's getting warm. So if I can fit this on there, that might help. Or, I mean, it should help a little. What else do I need to do? I was thinking, I don't know if I mentioned this or not, but I was thinking that I could... With these two big bolt holes right here, I could come up with a way to mount it to the bike. So, like, one of these is stationary but can pivot, and the other one can slide up and down a bracket, kind of like tensioning an alternator belt, and then clamping them down so that there's, of course, I mean, you know. If I am able to get a chain on there, it doesn't have to be super tight, because, you know, it's going to run on the teeth, but I am pretty jazzed that that there's a bearing in there though, but I already talked about that. So what else do I need to do then? Hi folks. This will be probably a short update, but I got all the parts cleaned up. I got all the grease out, all the old grease, so we're ready to put new grease in at some point. Everything cleaned up real nice. This guy cleaned up really well. I got all the old paint off, and so I got a nice smooth surface, which I'm hoping that, the plan is to smear thermal compound on this and then reduce this in size and clamp it on there for some heat dissipation. Oh, another thing I want to do is I want to go to the hardware store and pick up some springs that are a little less stiff to see if I can keep contact with the br the you know keep the brushes in contact with the rotor, but maybe with a little bit less pressure. So less pressure will cause less friction. I was watching YouTube, and the fellow suggested that most of the heat from this comes from the brushes being, scraping along the rotor. That makes sense, I guess. There are four brushes, and they are pressed up against here pretty hard. I mean, these aren't so bad, but until you get them really compressed, then there's a lot of pressure there. And I'm no expert in anything, but it seems to me that there shouldn't need to be that much pressure to push these things. As long as they make contact, good solid contact, they should be fine. And I'm going to use a different set of springs, so if it really doesn't work, I can always put the original springs back. So I'm not going to modify the original springs. I'm going to replace them with different springs, and I can modify those springs. So if I ruin those, I can always put these back, but I'm going to try that to try and reduce some of the heat that's happening in the first place. What else? Oh, and I'm going to replace the, well, now that the old grease is gone, I'm going to use high temperature grease in the hopes that even if this does still continue to be getting warm, hopefully the high temperature grease won't break down and it won't burn up. As far as I was able to get some of this stuff apart, as you can see here. I don't know if that showed up in the last part of the video, but I got this guy all apart, and it was another one of these clips and race ring deals that was up here at the top of this guy here. And this was much easier. It was just a matter of putting a little tiny screwdriver on there and whacking it with a hammer, and this popped right off, and then this guy pulled right out, no problem. And then this whole assembly came apart. This part goes here, but yeah, this whole assembly came apart, no problem. That was nice and easy. But then when I got in further into it, this channel here is held in place. All the rest of this is held in place by a weird spring clip that, or circlip that goes. It wraps around, but instead of the ends butting up against each other, it's like there's parts missing, and they sort of overlap. And I don't have a tool for separating something like that. I fiddle with it for quite a bit, and I obviously was unsuccessful. But it cleaned up okay the way it is. I was thinking of getting rid of this guide. I think what I'm gonna do, and forgive me if I've already gone through this, but I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna remove this little bit of aluminum to expose the inside race of the bearing here. And then, because the outside race is, in nice hard contact with the housing here, and then the inside race is supposed to spin independently, and that's exactly what I want this shaft to do. And so, what I'm thinking is have that shaft all the way out there, and then put a bushing that goes from that inner bearing all the way out to wherever the sprocket's going to be. And so that bushing will turn with the shaft, and it will rest on that bearing, which is also turning, so nothing is grinding against anything else that way. If I put it together as it is, the shaft will either be turning independently of that bushing, or the bushing will be grinding against that little bit of aluminum there. So if I get rid of that aluminum and get a slightly longer bushing to put over that, then that will keep this pr pushed out, and it will prevent it from going in, right? And so that will hold that stationary at, forwards and backwards, I guess, and allow it to rotate freely. Okay, I just got back from the hardware store, and I bought some springs. They were long, so I chopped the ends off of either side. But these are much more compressible than the original springs, and the ones I put in there are shorter. I haven't really assembled this properly yet. There's no grease or anything, but just real quick, I'm gonna have to recharge this. Oops, that's not it. Ah, turn off. There we go. This one. Click. Okay. So, be a few sparks, but watch this. Isn't that awesome? Works. And then let's see, turn that off. And another thing I've noticed is I can actually spin this by hand now backwards. Before, I had to put the pinion gear back on. Actually left a little mark. Oh, better not do that again. But anyway, so I thought that was pretty cool. That's one step in the right direction. Hey folks, check this out. I got the aluminum fins cut down and fitted to the main barrel there. I even cut out a little section to keep the positive away from the negative here, so and it doesn't interfere with the grommet. Hose clamps aren't really my first choice to secure this, but I'll figure something out later, hopefully. But anyway, there you have it.